Yeah, Amir Hyvönen, thanks for the invitation to come here. And I will be speaking about semantic networks of knowledge, and as Timo noted, this is one area that has actually arisen from artificial intelligence research, a kind of practical branch of artificial intelligence that establishes itself on the web. So I will first speak about the vision, what the semantic web and linked data is. They are here, whether we like it or not. And then the vision that has been sort of set up for creating the semantic web, and especially I will be focusing on the infrastructure that is needed for such a network of knowledge on the web. And also we'll be showing a few practical applications that we have been working on in our research group and otherwhere. So, what is the semantic web? It all started really at 2001 by this seminal article in the Scientific American written by Tim Berners-Lee, the father of the web, James Hendler, and a Finn, actually, Ora Lassila, who is a graduate of Aalto University and who was working with these guys at MIT. The idea of the semantic web is pictured here in one slide, so to say. So if you think of web, it's a web of pages. You have pages and then you have hyperlinks that link from one page to another. And when you browse the web, you move on from one page to another. But what's happening now, and has happened already, is the semantic web, also called the web of data, or giant global graph, GGG, as Tim Berners-Lee calls it. It's something that relates data inside of the web to each other. So if we have a sparrow and we know that a sparrow is a bird, then the link from sparrow to bird is part of the web of data. And the idea is that in order to make the web of pages, which we persons use, more usable, we must have this kind of web of data that the machines can understand. Because if the machine doesn't know what the web pages are about, it's very difficult to make any intelligent applications. So that's in short what the semantic web is about. Here's an example. This was a system that was actually deployed by the Health Institute in Finland, called Health Finland, and there you have basically documents like this on the web. That's the web for human users. And inside of that, you have the web of data. So each web content or whatever you have there on the web is related to knowledge about what the web pages or the data is about. So for example, here we have metadata about the web page Maijan Silmälasit, which means that this is a publication, and it was created by the National Health Organization, TTL, and it's in Finnish, it's text, it was created in these days, and it's about glasses, working conditions, working with a screen, and so on. So this metadata is something that then the machine can understand and do reasoning about. And now this initiative that started 15 years ago has sort of become very widespread. People around the world are collecting data into huge pools of data, into the open data cloud, which you can see here. And there are also other data clouds around on the web. The idea is that actually it started to evolve over and around Wikipedia. From Wikipedia they created DBpedia, which is a semantic representation of the old Wikipedias in the world. And then, so this bubble here represents Wikipedia data for machines to use. Then we have other bubbles here, like GeoNames, something like 9 million different places all around the world. And so on. So every data set is represented here, a bubble, and these links between the bubbles mean that these data is interlinked with each other in order to enrich each other. So for example, in DBpedia you may find Helsinki, the city, but it's also here in GeoNames. From GeoNames you can find the geometrical characteristics of Helsinki that perhaps are not present in DBpedia. So in this way, these bubbles create a network of knowledge and based on lots of different kind of data sets in media, geographical knowledge, applications, user-generated content, government, cross-domain, life sciences, social networking, you name it. That's a global picture. And because it's so global, the big boys have entered the game, so you might have heard about Google Knowledge Graph, which they are using in their machine search engine in order to help us in finding documents. And Microsoft is speaking about Satori. They also have a similar kind of network of knowledge that they are using in their services, like search engines. So this is becoming sort of mainstream stuff, not anymore something very new. So the question is, given this kind of big mega trend on the web, why do we need semantic web? I've collected here a couple of challenges that we try to solve with this approach. So the first question is the limitations of non-semantic search. Here's an example taken from the Museum Finland system that we created 10 years ago already, where we get information like this from the collections of the National Board of Antiquities, the National Museum. So here we have a database which tells that this is an artifact, it's cup and plate, it's porcelain, made in Germany, and creator is Meissen. We can immediately understand by ourselves, but if we try to search this kind of information from a database and require the machine to return all vessels, nothing is returned because this is a cup and plate. Or if we are searching for ceramic products, nothing is returned because this is porcelain. Or if you want to find artifacts manufactured in Europe, nothing is returned because this is made in Germany. Or if we ask, does the city of Meissen manufacture ceramics? Then we might say, perhaps, yes, but it's the wrong answer. Because this Meissen is not the city of Meissen, but it's the factory of Meissen that's nearby Meissen. It's like Nokia, the city in Finland and also the manufacturer. There are two different things, but the machine cannot make the distinction between these concepts. So how it is solved? The basic idea is like this. We link the data that we have there for human consumption, not only to these literal strings that we can understand as humans, but also to concepts, to ontologies that tell the machine what these concepts mean. So for example, the creation place, Germany. Here we link the place to Germany, which is part of Europe, in a place ontology. Or the concept of Meissen, in this case it's an actor Meissen, so it's an actor ontology. We have also Meissen here as part of Germany, but we can here make the distinction between Meissen the factory and Meissen the place. And now we can ask the questions, find all vessels. Okay, since cups and plates are vessels in our object ontology, we can return that this is a vessel. Or ceramic products, we have the material ontology here, it's porcelain, and so on. And we cannot solve the problem if you want to find out the city, what is Meissen, because it can be either a city or a factory, but we can at least tell the user that, what do you mean? Do you mean the city of Meissen, or do you mean the factory of Meissen? So we can make the distinction. So here's another example system that was created for the Rijksmuseum in Amsterdam. A very similar system where you have metadata about the artifact, in this case the Night Watch, famous Rembrandt painting. And here you see that the culture that this is related is this code here. And it's Amsterdam in DGM ontology, this means it. And this the material here is another reference to this kind of identifier. And if you then look, if you know what TGN is, it's actually an ontology created by Getty Foundation, you will find that Amsterdam is a city, the capital of Netherlands, so with lots of additional data here, when it was established and so on, who lived there, and whatever. And you can also see here that actually all these hits here are different Amsterdams around the world. So Amsterdam is a very ambiguous concept. There are tens of Amsterdams in the States, for example, or perhaps 20 different Amsterdams around the world. But because this reference was made using this URI, the identifier, the system can really, really understand that in this case we are speaking about the capital of the Netherlands and not some Amsterdam in some US state, for example. And now that we have the network, we have the knowledge in network in a structured form that we can reason about, you are able to not only search for documents as usual, but also some other fun things. So for example, this is an example that when I'm searching for connections between two things. So I'm here interested how Napoleon, the Bonaparte, the emperor, is related to Axel Kallen-Kallela, a famous Finnish painter. And since we have everybody here in a network, we can really, really create the link here. I'm not sure if you can see it, but it's here that Axel Kallen-Kallela, his teacher was Adolf Becker, whose teacher were Gunnar Berntsson and so on. So this kind of semantic relations that we know about how these people were related can give us an answer how two people are related, and we can actually visualize here the connection, the network of people as well. So this kind of networks and analysis on them is now becoming very popular in digital humanities, for example. Then the challenge two, multilinguality, which is very important in if you think of web, which is full of different languages. This is the solution. I would say that if you're looking for multilingual technologies, you should look at semantic web, because the idea or central idea on the semantic web is to use identifiers, language neutral identifiers for concepts and things that are there. So for example here, this URI web address, actually these kind of addresses are used for identification on the semantic web of Tchaikovsky. If you look at the different ways how it's transliterated in different languages, which are all correct, you can find lots of different ways. And if you're looking for Tchaikovsky, and if you're looking for strings, it might be very difficult to find a document in let's say in Italy. If you try to spell Tchaikovsky, I couldn't do that at least. But in the case of using semantic web, we know that it's this concept, and we can automatically, for example, switch languages because we know the labels. We have differentiated the labels from the concepts and indexed all data based on this kind of language neutral identifiers. That's a key idea there. Then challenge three, content heterogeneity and linking. If you think cultural heritage, for example, as a domain and what kind of things are out there, it's a very versatile domain. You have, for example, biographies here of Axel Kallen-Kallela, the paintings that he painted, the book that was inspired by him and related to the painting, music composed by Sibelius perhaps. You might have videos, maps, the chair where he sat, Wikipedia data and so on. So it's very, very interrelated world. And this applies nearly everywhere actually. There are lots of relations that we don't think about. And it would be nice then to have give the person, if you are interested in actually Kallen-Kallela, you would like to have access to all this kind of knowledge based on your interest. However, it's not possible at the moment, not easily, unless you are using semantic web technologies that I will show you later. And then at the same time that we have this kind of diversity of different kind of contents, we have the problem of cultural content production system, where the idea is that every player in the game is producing the data independently from each other. So we have a land survey that's photographing the land, we have museums, archives, libraries, we have media content, we have Wikipedia and similar kind of resources, we have the linked data cloud with lots of data available, and there's no connections between these things because everybody is using their own systems for representing the data, and so it's a mess. But on the other hand, it's of course also the strength of the web that we don't have this kind of rules, because then everybody can produce very easily new content on the web. But it's still a problem, and in the future we need more collaboration actually between these players in order to make the data interoperable, so that if I put something there, it's connected to the other data sets as well. So how can we solve these problems? Here's a picture that's sort of we have been using, and it's a very nice way of seeing the thing, I think. So we have the data producers here. In this case, digital humanities area is used as example of the previous slides. And then these guys are producing data. And when they produce data, let's say this book from a library, then we have this Finonto, in Finnish case, the Finonto ontology infrastructure that everybody knows about and can use. And when the content here is described in terms of the content, in terms of the concepts that are defined here, then this book is automatically connected, for example, here. Because also the biographies here are annotated, described for the machine using the same context. So this is a game where everybody wins, because if you publish new piece of data in this sample kind of system, then it's automatically connected to other data, and your data gets richer because it's more linked with other stuff. And at the same moment, if you put there a new piece of data, everybody other's data gets richer as well. So this is sort of something that's very, very nice for everybody. It makes sense to participate in this kind of system. And this kind of systems are now being implemented in many, many places, that Europeana, on the European level even, is using the same concept. That we were actually the first, I must say, first in the world, even in Finland, with the Museum Finland system, which was the first one to publish data in this way, from different collections at the same time. Now, what is it in practice? I'm using here the culture sample as a kind of case study, but it's just an example how to make the trick, so to say. So if we look at the different players, we have a biography center, for example, collecting biographies of people. And we know, for example, there that this H1 is actually Gallen Gallela, who is an artist born in Lemu, and Gustav Mannerheim Marshall, born in Askainen. This kind of relational data from databases is available everywhere. And the idea is that we translate this kind of data formats into network of knowledge like this. So you have here the same data represented as a graph like this. At the same time, there's a museum, art museum collection, where there is a picture of Mannerheim painted by Akseli Gallen Gallela this year. So, and there's Aino Triptych paid by the same artist, and it's related to Aino and Kalevala like this. So you get another piece of network here. And then you get the land survey data that Askainen is part of Varsinais-Suomen lääni, and Helsinki is part of Uudenmaan lääni, a larger county in Finland, and so on. So you get this kind of data about how the places are related to each other. And then we were developing these ontologies, general ontologies, for example. We have physical objects like human being, painting. We have professions like artist and marshal, and we have places like county and government here. And when you put all these pieces then together, then the magic happens like this. The color codes are showing the different parts. So things are related to each other. And suddenly, for example, when I was making this example, I noticed that Askainen and Lemu, the birthplaces of Marshall Mannerheim and Akseli Gallen Kalela, they're actually part of the same part of Finland. So that might be the reason it turned out that Akseli Gallen Kalela was actually doing lots of stuff for Gustav Mannerheim, because perhaps they knew each other even because they were from the same part of Finland. So this kind of serendipitous knowledge can sometimes come out of the network. When you put pieces together, the sum is bigger than any part independently, and that's the great promise to the semantic web, that you put data together and you find something new that you couldn't find before. It's also possible to, when you have this kind of representations, also use logic for reasoning new kinds of relations that you have there. So that's another dimension that you can try to find how things are related in ways that you would not know before. So key idea actually from a more technical viewpoint, I go back to this later on, is that we have this kind of bubble sea of data, which in this case was culture sample. And then you might even have another mini bubble inside of the bigger bubble. For example, this is the book sample, the kirjasampo.fi portal that's now actually used by something like 80,000 people monthly. And it's based on the same technology, and it's actually part of our culture sample data originally. And then once you have a very nice representation of the data as a graph, then you can use the APIs, programming interfaces for creating different kind of applications. Like we created the culture sample, and the library people created the kirja sample, book sample portal. Or if you have an application idea, you can create your own with the same interfaces. So that this makes it very useful. Once you have the data in good shape and you can publish it using these standard ways, everybody can enjoy them and do whatever applications they like there and reuse the data. So for example, this data is openly available and you can use it for whatever you like and create new applications. So it's a nice way of opening data. So I'm not going in details here, but I just show you some slides of the user interfaces. We actually created 9 different perspectives to the data set that we created in culture sample. So we have, they are here, and if you click something, then you get, for example, you can see museum collections on maps, or you can have even historical maps here on Weiburg, for example, and different data related to that area in Karelia. Or the relational search was also implemented in this setting that I showed you already. You can try to find relations between people, famous people, and you can even create represent intangible cultural heritage like rubber booth making or leather booth making in this case. So you can also represent processes if you want to store skills on a database. Or we would even translated Kalevala into RDF. So we have a semantic Kalevala published with the Finnish Literature Society when the Kalevala stories are annotated and represented in terms of semantic web. And when you look, for example, the first poem here, it's automatically linked to art in the National Gallery and so on. So in this way you can enrich Kalevala reading experience by links to other related stuff like Vanhat. Suomen kansan vanhat runot and all kinds of stuff. Okay, I think we can make a short break here and then I will go into more details regarding semantic infrastructure.